Well, we'd like to thank you for being with us today. And God is very good, and we are certainly thankful to be here. Last week we talked about the total sufficiency of Christ to be our complete Savior. And this week we're on part two, the sufficiency of Christ to be our total Savior. And these slides that we'll be looking at today, some of these statements and images, are found on the Internet. You can download them at our website at smyrna.org, and they are available for you. And, of course, if you get the video, they're already right here. I'd like to begin by turning to Genesis chapter 28. Genesis chapter 28, verses 10 through 12. And Jacob went out from Beersheba and went toward Haran. And he lighted up a certain place and tarried there all night because the sun was set. And he took of the stones of that place and put them for his pillows and lay down in that place to sleep. And he dreamed, and behold, a ladder set up on the earth, and the top of it reached to heaven, and behold, the angels of God ascending and descending on it. Now, he saw a ladder, and we know that, as we've studied in the past, that this ladder represented Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, who could reach all the way from heaven down to earth. Now, I want you to think about a ladder for just a minute. A ladder's rungs that we climb on are supported by two pillars, aren't they? Mm-hmm. And those two pillars in this ladder go all the way to the earth and reach all the way to the heaven in Jacob's dream. Now, we think at times of the fundamental principles of faith that support our message. And we call them the pillars of our faith. In Proverbs chapter 9 and verse 1, it says, "Wisdom hath hewed out her seven pillars." Do you remember what those seven pillars are? We talked about them about a year ago a good bit, didn't we? Remember talking about the seven pillars? Well, I'm going to let you review. If we go to our next slide, we have here a slide of the pillars of our faith. The entire message of Seventh-day Adventism rests upon these pillars and this foundation. The foundation supports the pillars. The foundation is that Jesus is the Son of God. And we noted that these seven pillars were the law and the Sabbath. And if you have the slides, you see that I've given Spirit of Prophecy references for each one to substantiate where she defines this as a pillar, a foundational, important doctrine. The law and the Sabbath, the personality of God in Christ, the faith of Jesus, the sanctuary, the three angels' messages, the testimony of Jesus, which, of course, is a Spirit of Prophecy, and the non-immortality of the wicked. And she says that these are the pillars of our faith. Now, within this pillar, the second pillar in this particular graphic, the personality of God in Christ, within that there's a lot of things that are encompassed. And one of them is this subject we've been discussing for the last several weeks called the incarnation. The incarnation. And the truth of the incarnation stands upon the victory of Jesus over two areas that Satan uses as strongholds against us. Now, when we think about Satan and the weapons he uses against us and the way he works against us, we think usually of doctrines. We think of doctrines like Sunday worship, the Trinity. We think of doctrines like eternal hell, the immortal soul. We think of doctrines like no heavenly atonement. And we think of doctrines like faith without works. Those are things that we think of when we think of weapons and tools of Satan. And of course, he does use false teaching a lot. But there are two different tools that he finds great success with, which really don't even deal specifically with doctrine. And they're not alcohol and they're not tobacco. But those are problems, by the way. And there's help for all those things in Jesus. But there are two weapons which we actually ourselves provide him. Did you know that? They are, as we go to our next slide, the hereditary nature of man and the cultivated tendencies to sin. I assure you that Satan uses these two strongholds of his, which we provide him, to do some of his greatest work. And now we want to examine today some of the last few hours of our Savior's life and to see how he provides total victory over the hereditary nature of man, over our tendencies to sin which we have accumulated, and how he is a total Savior. Now, we have four books in the New Testament, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. We call those the Gospels. And which one of those Gospels is significantly different from the other three? John. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are all very similar. In fact, we call those the synoptic Gospels because they give us a synoptic or a synopsis of the life of Christ. They all are very similar. They cover mostly the same things, just in varying detail. And there's another one that's called the didactic gospel. We'll talk about it in a minute, but that's John. But Matthew, Mark, and Luke are the synoptics, and they form a general outline of the life of Christ. They give a summary or synopsis, in other words, of his life. And in the last part of his life, when we come to that time that we call the Passover or the Lord's Supper, they're all very similar. In fact, if you turn with me to Matthew chapter 26, they present an emphasis. Matthew chapter 26. In the first part of this chapter, Matthew 26 begins with the ruler's conspiracy against Christ. It's followed by Mary's anointing of Christ, then Judas's betrayal, the Passover supper itself, Christ's telling of the betrayal, and now we come down to verse 26. Matthew 26, 26. And as they were eating, Jesus took bread and blessed it and broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took the cup and gave thanks, and gave it to them, saying, "Drink ye all of it, for this is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many for the remission of sins." And that's the account in Matthew chapter 26. Now, what's the parallel chapter in Mark? Anybody remember? You want to take a good educated guess? There's only 16 chapters in Mark. It's probably near the end, right? Close. Mark chapter 14. We turn over to Mark chapter 14. Like the Gospel of Matthew, it begins with the conspiracy against Christ, the anointing that Mary does, the betrayal of Judas, Christ telling of the betrayal, and then the Passover supper. And then we come to verse 22. And as they did eat, Jesus took bread and blessed and broke it and gave to them and said, "Take, eat, this is my body." And he took the cup. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them, and they all drank of it. And he said unto them, "This is my blood of the New Testament, which is shed for many." So we see very similar here. Basically the same record that Matthew gives. Well, what about Luke? Does Luke do something similar? Yes, he does. Luke 22. If we go over to Luke chapter 22, and we won't belabor this much more here. In Luke chapter 22, we have the conspiracy against Jesus in the first part. We have the betrayal of Judas. We don't have the anointing listed here. It's listed elsewhere due to Luke's unique way of presenting it. But we have the Passover, the communion, and then the statement of betrayal. But right here in the middle of this, in Luke 22, verse 19, "And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave unto them, saying, 'This is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me.' Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the New Testament in my blood which is shed for you.'" Now, we see here in this service the Lord commemorating his death, and that they were to see this as a symbol of his death until he came. The bread and the wine represent the body and the blood of Jesus Christ. And we acknowledge and accept his sacrifice through the partaking of the communion symbols or emblems and acknowledge his death till he comes. But John's gospel is different. You start to think about the gospel account of John, how he relates this supper. Now, I mentioned that we called in our next slide John's gospel the didactic gospel. And that is a Greek word, didactic. It comes from didasko, which is a Greek word that means to teach. The didactic gospel is a gospel of teaching. John is not so much interested in giving all the details of the life of Jesus, because remember, this was one of the last books of the New Testament written. One of the last books of the New Testament written, perhaps decades after Matthew, Mark, and Luke had written. That basic scenario, life story, had been presented of Jesus. John is now trying to teach some very specific lessons, and that's why you find a lot of material unique in John. It's not in any of the other Gospels. And here in John's Gospel, if we turn to John chapter 13, we find that the communion service is not touched upon by John at all. He doesn't mention this bread and this wine. That's not his point. He has something else that he has to include that's important that hasn't been taught yet. And it's something that has a tremendous lesson for us. In John chapter 13, beginning in verse 2. And supper being ended, the devil having now put into the heart of Judas Iscariot, Simon's son, to betray him. Jesus, knowing that the Father had given all things into his hands, and that he was come from God and went to God, he rises from supper and laid aside his garments and took a towel and girded himself. After that he poureth water into a basin and began to wash the disciples' feet and to wipe them with the towel wherewith he was girded. Verse 6. Then cometh he to Simon Peter, and Peter saith unto him, Lord, dost thou wash my feet? Jesus answered and said unto him, What I do thou knowest not now, but thou shalt know hereafter. Verse 8, Peter saith unto him, Thou shalt never wash my feet. Jesus answered him, If I wash thee not, thou hast no part with me. Now friends, that's something important for us to remember, that this washing and this lesson from the washing, if we don't partake of it, we have no part with Jesus Christ. Now let's think about this symbolism. Here they are, they're gathered in the upper room for the Passover. And there was a custom that was to be done. And that was to be when the people came in, their feet were to be washed. But this was not done by just anyone. This was done only by servants. In fact, it wasn't even done by Jewish servants. It was always done by a foreign servant. In fact, we have a statement here from the Seventh-day Adventist Bible commentary in our next slide. This is not from the Ellen White comments, by the way. This is just the commentators. It says, according to Jewish custom, extending back probably to the time of Jesus, the washing of the master's feet was one of the duties of a foreign slave. Inasmuch as no servant was present on the occasion of the Last Supper, one of the disciples should have undertaken the task, but none volunteered. That's from the Seventh-day Adventist Bible Commentary, Volume 5, page 1028. Now, if you look here in the account in John 13, verse 4 again, it says that Jesus rose from the supper. He laid aside his garments, and he girded himself with a towel. It's interesting that if you look in the Greek, for this word garments in our next slide, this word garment is from the word hematia, but the Greek word is, the root word is hematia, and it means an outer garment, an outer garment. And that has a significance to it, and we're going to come back to that in just a minute. But then it says that he girded himself with a towel. And the Greek word for towel is lention. Do you ladies have any linens in your closet? That's where this word comes from. And he girded himself with a towel. And interestingly, Thayer, in his Greek-English lexicon, speaks about this towel as that with which it was supposed the nakedness of persons undergoing crucifixion was covered. Jesus was willing to be the slave for sinners so that they need not perish. In Philippians chapter 2, verse 5, he says, Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the what? The form of God. Thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, and was made in the likeness of men. The English Standard Version says, Having this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men. Christ shed his outer garment. He shed that covering of divinity and took upon him the towel representing the slave form.
Amen.
You see? And he washed their feet. And this washing was a symbol, not only of their feet being clean, but of being washed with the blood of Jesus Christ. In Revelation chapter 1 and verse 5, And from Jesus Christ, who is the faithful witness and the first begotten of the dead, and the prince of the kings of the earth, unto him that loved us and washed us from our sins in his own blood. What can wash away my sins? Nothing but the blood of Jesus. You know, I have a laundry, a washer, you know, to do my laundry. And when I want to clean white things, I put bleach in. Can you imagine having a soiled garment and you're wanting to make it white and you pour in red food coloring or red dye? That's probably not going to help it. But what if you literally poured blood in? Why, it's one of the worst stains to try to take out, isn't it? And it seems like such a paradox, such an oxymoron almost, as it were. But this is what we can take our filthy garments and dip them into the blood of Christ, and they become white as snow. Hebrews chapter 1 and verse 3 also. Who being the brightness of his glory and the express image of his person, upholding all things by the word of his power, when he had by himself purged our sins, set down on the right hand of the majesty on high. He purged our sins. He washed them in his blood. Now, let's go back to John 13 because there's a question. John chapter 13 and verse 12. So after he washed their feet and had taken his garments and was set down again, he said unto them, and really what he did, he asked them a question now. Know ye what I have done to you? And I'd like to extend this concept. Do you know what he has done for you to be able to do this to you? Do you understand this concept that he laid aside his outer garment? He laid aside his divinity to become a man, to die for us. And Jesus says, Peter, if you don't get this, if you don't become involved in this, there's no salvation. And there's no salvation for us, friends, if we can't understand and appreciate the humanity of Christ. It is so foundational. It is so pivotal to the plan of salvation. To believe that Jesus Christ truly became a man. To live as we have to live. To go through the battles that we have to go through. And not to be spared an iota of that at all. In the Review and Herald of September 4, 1900, we have a very intriguing statement. It says, now of the human, speaking of the human nature of Christ, now of the human, he was made in the likeness of men, and being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death. He voluntarily assumed human nature. It was his own act, and by his own consent. He clothed his divinity with humanity. Why, he was all the while as God, but he did not appear as God. He veiled the demonstrations of deity, which had commanded the homage and called forth the admiration of the universe of God. He was God while upon earth, but he divested himself of the form of God, and in its stead took the form and fashion of a man. He walked the earth as a man. For our sakes he became poor, that we through his poverty might be made rich. He laid aside his glory and majesty. He was God. But the glories of the form of God he for a while relinquished. Review and Herald, September 4, 1900. And then from Manuscript Releases, Volume 10, page 173. It says, Jesus laid off his royal robe, his kingly crown, and clothed his divinity with humanity. Why did he do that? She tells us, continuing, in order to become a substitute and surety for humanity, that dying in humanity, he might by his death destroy him who had the power of death. He could not have done this as God, but by coming as man, Christ could die. By death, he overcame death. The death of Christ bore to the death him who had the power of death and opened the gates of the tomb for all who would receive him as their personal Savior. Jesus became a man for us. And he had to become a man to be able to bear the sins of this world. And at Calvary, because he was still God, because he was still divine, his sacrifice was equivalent to God who is divine and who is infinite. And we're told that his sacrifice for us was indeed an infinite sacrifice. If I could go to the next slide, which is from the Review and Herald of April 30, 1901. It says, Christ has made an infinite sacrifice. He gave his own life for us. He took upon his divine soul the result of the transgression of God's law, laying aside his royal crown. He condescended to step down, step by step, to the level of fallen humanity. He hung upon Calvary's cross, dying in our behalf, that we might have eternal life. Review and Herald, April 30, 1901. And so at the cross, Jesus Christ met the final aspect of the law of equivalence. At his birth, he accepted the fallen nature of man. And at the cross, he now accepts the committed sins of the world. In Isaiah chapter 53 and verse 6, it says, the Lord hath laid on him the what? The iniquity of just a few, of only the chosen, the iniquity of us all. And the Bible says, he who knew no sin became sin for us, that the righteousness of the law might be fulfilled in us. 2 Corinthians 5:21. He became sin for us. In the youth instructor of April 25, 1901, it says that when Christ bowed his head and died, he bore, now notice this, he bore the pillars of Satan's kingdom with him to the earth. He vanquished Satan in the same nature over which in Eden Satan obtained the victory. The enemy was overcome by Christ in his human nature. The power of the Savior's Godhead was hidden. He overcame in human nature, relying upon God for power. This is so interesting. He bore the pillars of Satan's kingdom. Well, you know, I might be thinking he took the Trinity. He took the immortal soul. Now, those are doctrines, but those aren't the pillars of what Satan's kingdom really works upon. She goes on to say in that same statement, this is the privilege of all. In proportion to our faith will be our victory. And so he overcame all the hereditary tendencies and problems that we have in humanity. And he overcame, even on the cross, as the sin of the world was laid upon him, and the cultivated tendencies of sin were laid upon him. Not that he had cultivated any ever, but he took our sin. And he understood what it was like when, you know, we had these temptations that we have brought upon ourselves, not our ancestors. Our ancestors have brought enough upon us through our heredity. You know, I can look at Bob and I can look at Brother Leon here, and I can tell they're brothers, not just because they have the same hairline and similar beards, but there's other things that tell me that they have a hereditary source, you see. But each one has different cultivated tendencies to sin that they have fed throughout their lives, just as I have and just as you have. And those cultivated tendencies and the urges that they could propel were laid upon Christ at the cross. And now the question is, will humanity stand up? Will humanity that can be aided by the power of God stand up? And Christ proved indeed that it could. In fact, and sin, friends, don't forget, sin is the one source of power that Satan has. If we would notice this next statement from the youth instructor, especially the last part of it, this is from June 28, 1900. It says, through death, the Savior destroyed him that had the power of death. In the very act of grasping his prey, death was vanquished, for by dying, Christ brought to light life and immortality through the gospel. Never was the Son of God more beloved by his Father, by the heavenly family, and by the inhabitants of the unfallen worlds than when he humbled himself to bear disgrace, humiliation, shame, and abuse. By becoming the sin-bearer, he lifted from the human race the curse of sin. In his own body, he paid the penalty of that on which the power of Satan over humanity is found, sin. Friends, sin is what gives Satan power over us. But he could have no power over Jesus Christ. Christ in his own body brought down the pillars of sin upon which the kingdom of Satan rests. Those two pillars, the weakened hereditary nature of man and the cultivated tendencies to sin that have become a part of man. These were unbreakable patterns of habit that we have acquired, and apart from the power of God, we would be condemned forever. For 30 years, Jesus demonstrated that weakened heredity was no excuse for sin. And at the cross, he demonstrated that even cultivated tendencies are no excuse for sin. Jesus could carry the weight of this load. He did remain faithful. He did remain true. He did understand experientially what these habit patterns of sin do and the draw that they have. And yet, in the amazement of this suffering, he drank the dregs to the last bitter drop. There's a statement in the Bible commentary that's from a letter of Ellen White's. It's volume 5 of the commentary, page 1108. The dark cloud of human transgression came between the Father and the Son. The interruption of the communion between God and his Son caused a condition of things in the heavenly courts which cannot be described by human language. So I won't even try. I'd only fail. It says, nature could not witness such a scene as Christ dying in agony while bearing the penalty of man's transgression. God and the angels clothed themselves with darkness and hid the Savior from the gaze of the curious multitude while he drank the last dregs of the cup of God's wrath. That wrath against sin. And so, beloved, even though the Father had hid his presence from his Son in the darkness, even though Ellen White says in Desire of Ages, page 753, that Jesus could not see through the portal of the tomb, by faith, Jesus Christ grasped the pillars of Satan's kingdom and brought them down. And there's a parallel experience in the Bible. In the book of Judges, chapter 16, there's an object lesson in this. Remember a man named Samson? And he had quite a vacillating experience. But at the end, his eyes had been blinded and he'd been put at a grinding mill. And then finally, he'd been brought out into the temple of Dagon, to make sport of. And notice what it says in verse 26 now. And Samson said unto the lad that held him by the hand, suffer me that I may feel the pillars whereupon the house standeth, that I may lean upon them. Now the house was full of men and women, and all the lords of the Philistines were there. And there were upon the roof about 3,000 men and women that beheld while Samson made sport. And Samson called unto the Lord and said, O Lord God, remember me, I pray thee, and strengthen me, I pray thee, only this once, O God, that I may be at once avenged of the Philistines of my two eyes. And Samson took hold of the two middle pillars. What did he take hold of? Two middle pillars, upon which the house stood, and on which it was borne up, and the one with his right and the other with his left. And Samson said, let me die with the Philistines. And he bowed himself with all of his might, and the house fell upon the lords and upon all the people that were therein. And says he killed more people in his death than he had in his life. As he grasped those two pillars that supported the temple, this temple of Dagon, and he destroyed the temple of the devil into a pile of rubbish, and in so doing, he died. And Jesus destroyed the two pillars of Satan's strength, and in so doing, he died. But he didn't die, friends, to stay dead forever, because he who knew no sin, did no sin, sin could not hold him, and he was resurrected by God. But he resisted unto blood in his life as he strived against sin. When Jesus cried out, it is finished, in John chapter 19, verse 30, he was declaring the great demonstration had been completed. He was saying that the law of equivalence had been met. He was saying that Satan's charges had been refuted, and man, not just simply him, but mankind had overcome. He had overcome Satan using only power that is available to you and to me. A.T. Jones, remember who he was? Mm-hmm. In 1895, in the General Conference, you can find it in those General Conference talks, in the bulletin there of February 21, 1895. Oh, he is a complete Savior. He is a Savior from sins committed and the conqueror of the tendencies to commit sins. In him we have the victory. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verse 57 says, thanks be unto God which giveth us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. We do have victory, don't we? It's available to each one of us. And it could be victory over the heredity that we've inherited. I know that as much as I love my dad, he had a quick temper. He wasn't patient. And I've inherited the tendency to have a quick temper. I've inherited the tendency to not be patient at all. But I can overcome that by Jesus Christ. Amen. And I know in my life, when I was younger, I acquired the tendency to do many wrong things before I became a Christian. But Jesus accepted those on the cross for me. And he got the victory for them, over them for me on the cross. And he will give me that victory today if I will cry out to him for help. He is able to help us. And so it could be our temper that we're born with. It could be the habit of tobacco. And Jesus is the answer. Jesus is the answer. He's the answer to the lust of the flesh, to the lust of the eyes, and the pride of life, right down the line. Now, I like something that Brother Bob said earlier today. He was talking about this diet that he's on now. And he said, you know, it's just helped me so much. He says, but there's so few people who want to do it. He says, the only thing that's been proven to fix heart disease, totally fix it. He says, but so few want to do it. And that's a shame, Bob. It's a shame. We should all want to do it. There's a lady I talk to at the bank sometimes when I go to the bank, and bless her heart, she's clearly in need of a diet. But she's always talking about food, and every time I go in there, I see she has a piece of chocolate cake, or she's getting the chicken, or she's getting turkey. And I said, you know, that stuff will kill you. That's okay. I just can't live without it. But she can if she wants to. Friends, a lot of it depends upon, in fact, everything depends upon the right action of what, Leon?
The will.
We have to want it. And if you want it, but Jesus said that's even based upon one simple word, and that's love. Because in John chapter 14, verse 15, Jesus said, if you love me, keep my commandments. If we love him, we'll do it. You know, why is it that now I'm almost 56 years old, and I still try in every way possible to obey my mother? I'm past 17, I'm past 18, I'm past 21. I left home when I was, really for good, I left home when I was 17 years old. Went to school, never really went back to live at home ever, but for just very short spurts until I got married and I was gone for permanent. I've never lived at home since then. Shouldn't I just be able to tell Mom, look, Mom, you know, just no way. I'm not going to do what you tell me to do. I'm not going to honor your requests. But bless her heart, I do try to honor your request, Mom. I think you're on listening, as best I know how to, as an obedient son. Because I love you. Now, the Bible says, honor thy father and thy mother. It says to do that. And I should do it because the Bible says to do it. But I should really want to do it because I love them. I love my mom. I love my dad, too. I put up, you don't know how much anyone who grew up with Russell Stump put up with. But I still loved him. I still loved him. And I love my mom. And she was a lot easier to grow up with, by the way. And she's gotten a lot easier since she's given her life to the Lord. And I love your mom. But we should love the Lord Jesus, because the first and the greatest commandment is to love the Lord thy God with all thy heart, soul, mind, and strength. Second is to love your neighbors yourself. But if we love God first, then we're going to want to do his will. I delight to do thy will, O my God, yea, thy law is in my heart. Psalms 40, verse 8. We should want to do it. And if we want to do it, he will provide the way to do it. It's like a man said one time against a task that seemed difficult to almost impossible. He said, find a way or make a way. Find a way or make a way. But friends, we have the way in John 14, verse 6. That's Jesus. He is the way, the truth, and the life. And we, each one, can come to God by him. And then our hopes, our greatest aspirations can become a reality.